Does it seem good? Are we good to start? Cool. Hi, everyone. Welcome to JVP's weekly event called Conversations with Movement Elders. Starting at the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic, each week a member of JVP sits down with someone we admire to talk about their life and the moment that we're in. Since last week's conversation with Kai, we've witnessed a historic 15,000 person march for Black trans lives, as well as continued violence and the deaths of Oluwatoyin Salau, Rayshard Brooks, Rhea Milton, Dominique Fells, and Robert Fuller. Their losses are immeasurable. Sitting together each week, we recommit ourselves to the movement for Black liberation, for gender and economic justice, and are guided by those who have been working for this for decades. This week, I'm honored to introduce Rosalind Petchesky. She is a longtime transnational activist, feminist activist, scholar of sexual and reproductive rights, and distinguished professor emerita at City University of New York. From the start, she committed herself to a feminism that was both anti-racist and class conscious, and carried such analysis to pathbreaking work on sterilization, abortion, and childcare, as well as designing women's studies programs and courses. Throughout major accomplishments, like winning the MacArthur Fellowship Genius Grant, she remained close to the pulse of social movements. She's lived a life in dialogue, in lifelong feminist friendships, being inspired both by her mentors and by her students. She's pushed organizations to be principled, feminism to be transnational, and education to be liberatory. I'm so excited to have today to hear how.
Thank you.
I wanted to start today's conversation. It really feels like history is very present with us since Tulsa is on the minds of everyone's because of President Trump's announcement to hold a rally there after Juneteenth, the site of a horrific massacre in 1921. This is also the place where you grew up and first became involved in civil rights. Could you tell me a little bit about growing up?
Wow, Tulsa. I honestly can't believe that Tulsa is so prominent right now. It's incredible. It is an amazing time we're in. First of all, Natalia, it is my pleasure and honor to be with you on this conversation. I just love you. You're actually a model of what it means to be a young person who's now bridging activism and scholarship. So yay, Natalia. And Tulsa, I mean, this time is incredible that he will not be named as having this rally in my hometown. Well, it's horrible and so near to Juneteenth. And the place where there was the biggest, not the only, but the biggest massacre of a Black community. Don't say riot. No, it was not a riot. It was a massacre in 1921. My mother was 2 years old. My grandparents migrated to Tulsa, just the way lots of Jewish immigrants didn't stay in New York. They went to other places in the country because they were encouraged to, because they thought they would have more opportunities. My grandfather went there because his brother was there. You know, not much of a story there. What the story is they were there in 1921. And we grew up not hearing one word about the racist massacre in our hometown, just a mile or so from where we lived. And still I am enraged by this fact. And to be honest, a lot of my friends, I stay in touch with a whole group of friends I went to grade school and high school with in Tulsa. We're all angry, and across a spectrum of politics, very, as white women, very, very angry at how our history was hidden from us. Well, Tulsa, we knew this early on. They taught us that it was the oil capital of the world. And we knew a lot of people who were in the oil business, not my family, but other Jewish families, actually. And, you know, I had a very privileged life. I mean, my father went to Tulsa to do his residency as a doctor. He was a radiologist. We had a very comfortable life. My father was in World War II. He was injured. He was in horrible atrocities in the South Pacific. He came back, he would never talk about the war, but he was very identified as a Jew. My grandparents were very Zionist. And that was a kind of piece of what I was growing up with. I thought, I really believed that Jews were especially anti-racist. I believed that. And I don't know where I got that idea from, but I was disillusioned later on. I just want to say a few more words about Tulsa, though. Tulsa was not only the oil capital of the world, Tulsa was the epicenter of white supremacy and white nationalism. You cannot imagine growing up in a place where the world headquarters of Oral Roberts, the evangelical preacher, priest, whatever he was right around the corner, right two blocks from our house. And this Christian evangelical ethos and culture surrounded us. I mean, when I was in school, you know, these athletes for Christ would come to school and we were supposed to stay in the assembly and my parents would write a note for me and I would go out in the hall all by myself and stand there. Wow. That's my association with Christians. We went to a grade school. My grade school was called Lee School, after you know who, Robert E. Lee. It's a scandal. It's astonishing. I was born in Texas because my father was stationed at an army base called Fort Hood. Fort Hood? Hood. He was one of those Confederate generals. They named the bases after. So racism was all around us. Racial divides were all around us. We lived in a part of town where it was just a few blocks from Greenwood. And Greenwood, we all knew, was where Black people lived. And there was a railroad that ran through where the downtown and Greenwood. But we didn't know very much about it. But at the same time, there was the early civil rights movement. And I became involved in something called, I don't know if you ever heard of it. It was called the National Conference of Christians and Jews. And it was kind of, the National Conference of Christians and Jews was a kind of liberal civil rights formation. And I was extremely gratified to learn that a friend of mine, a really lovely, wonderful friend of mine, Achebe Powell, who is a wonderful Black feminist organizer and thinker and friend, Achebe grew up in the South. I think it was North or South Carolina. And I invited Achebe to one of our JVP gatherings at the People's Forum. And there was Achebe. And then we were talking and she said, I said something about National Conference of Christians and Jews. And she said, I was in NCCJ. That was what started me in my radicalism. It was a Jewish Christian organization, an interfaith organization. And there was some Jewish guy, some rabbi who was very radical. And I said, oh my God, Achebe, we have this bond. It's unbelievable. It means so much. I was through NCCJ. I mean, I think I gave my first talk, public talk. They asked me to go talk to this all Black. It was a junior high school, it's middle school. And I went there and I spoke. I don't have any idea what I talked about. And my memory is that I looked out and it was all Black kids. And I think really, in part of my mind, I thought, what am I doing here? What do I know about them? What do they know about me? Why do they need to hear from me? Why am I here? It's a big mystery. It doesn't make any sense. Well, the one thing we did, I got involved in civil rights in high school. We didn't have a SNCC chapter in our town. We had a CORE chapter and I became part of CORE. I was involved. The one thing I remember, I have this memory of going in high school. This friend of mine, Dave Campbell, was the president of the student council, and I was the secretary of the student council. And we had a friend, Peaches Little John, who was African American. We had Black kids in our school, but not a whole lot. So Peaches and her friend, who was a young African American boy, and I don't remember his name, and Dave and I did a double date. We planned this. It was a strategy. We said, all right, we're going to the basketball game. And we're going to walk in to the school gym, the four of us together. And we did. we walked in, and I just remember complete silence. Mm. Nobody yelled, nobody said slurs, nobody said anything. They were just like, and we walked in and we sat down and we stayed at the basketball game and we went back to my parents and had ice cream. Mm. I mean, that was considered a radical thing to do. Can you imagine just going to a basketball game? Just one more thing about this. It's not about Tulsa exactly, but I do want to say this because it's part of my formation and my memories. And, you know, when I was very young, maybe 11 or 12, the film Gone with the Wind was being shown. It wasn't made then. It was later, but it was being shown in Tulsa. And I have to say, because it was just a review of a whole article in the New York Times about Gone with the Wind, and it was all about, you know, racism and how Black people had always opposed Gone with the Wind. And I wanted to say, yeah, and it's about gender too. It's about gender. And it's a cultural artifact that implanted in white girls like me a kind of obstacle to anti-racism because it introduced us to this romance. I wanted to be Vivian Leigh and have an affair with Rhett Butler. I wanted that glamour. I wanted that. In those days. And it took me until now to remember the role that Gone with the Wind played in messing up some of my consciousness. I thought I was anti-racist. I lived an anti-racist life. And I tried to anyway. But there was this other thing that's about being a white woman, white womanhood. What is that? And it's something we still have a long way to go to untangle from our efforts to fight racism. Natalia, take it on.
Yeah, that is really incredible just to hear, especially towards the end, because I feel like I've read about the history of white Southern womanhood, but there is something very different about when you get to hear it a person telling about their life. Also, I'll just keep myself on mute when I'm not talking because there is always construction happening in my building. Sorry about that before the sounds. I guess I'd like to move towards your work as a graduate student. Who did you study with? What did you study? What was the kind of political moment of graduate school?
Well, I went to graduate school at Columbia during the Columbia strike and the anti-war movement. So that was highly significant. I want to say, though, that I went to college as an undergraduate. I went to Smith College, and my mentor there was Ibrahim Abulagud. And Ibrahim was a tremendous support and influence on me. He was a great Palestinian intellectual. He worked with Edward Said. He worked with Yasser Arafat behind the scenes. And I feel very privileged to have studied with him. Years later, many years later, I did go to Palestine with a delegation of Eyewitness Palestine, and I'm very, very devoted to this organization, Eyewitness Palestine, which sponsors these terrific trips. I had gone in high school, I'm skipping back, Natalia, forgive me, but I'm just going back.
Perfect.
Yeah, no, I did go on a trip to Israel when I was 16 years old. And that was 1959, you guys. It was in the midst of the civil rights movement. And I was so excited. I was so, you know, I was like these birthright kids. I want to go to Israel and I'm going to, you know, make my life there. And I don't know what kind of bullshit I thought. Anyway, I witnessed racism right in front of me so starkly, and it contradicted everything I thought. I thought Jews were ethical. I thought we were against racism. We called it prejudice. That's what I had known since I was a little kid. And there it was, blatant racism. I wrote about this in this little book that we published, you know, called Confronting Zionism. The story is in there so people can read it if you want. I was so shocked and so upset and so angry. because the people at the, especially the men at home, didn't believe me. And I was part of the civil rights movement in high school and in college. And I tried to borrow my father's car to take kids. I took a whole lot of us, black and white, and we went to integrate the swimming pools. It was part of the public accommodations struggle in the 60s. And we went to this swimming pool and we all came out and we said, let's go swimming, the public swimming pool. And they said, well, no, you can't, no. Mm-mm. We went back a few days later and there was a big sign said closed. So I had been doing those things, but I thought they were compatible with Jewishness, or how I understood Jewishness. But that trip to Israel just knocked me for a loop. And it really changed my relationship to Judaism, to my father. It was hard. And so going back, I wouldn't go back to Israel. There was no way. So when I had an opportunity to go to Palestine, which I call all of historic Palestine, it was amazing. And one of the things I did was to visit Birzeit University and the Institute for International Studies that Professor Abulagood had founded when he taught there. He was no longer alive. And I saw his portrait hanging on the wall of the Institute. And I was so proud and I was so sad. And also proud to speak to the young woman who is now the director of that institute and hear all the people he had taught, Marwan Barghouti, and you know, all these leaders, these Palestinian leaders. He had been such a force. And I just felt so blessed to have known this amazing man. Well, Colombia was a site of, great ferment. I mean, we were marching against the war. We had so much to do against the war, and we were also becoming feminists. So I was in this double-pronged movement against the Vietnam War and for gender justice and women's liberation. We called it women's liberation. So it was an amazing time, just amazing. I think Sherry Gorelick was on this series before, and she mentioned being part of, taking over buildings. We occupied a building called Fairweather Hall, which is where all the political science classes were, and we just took it over, and there we were. And we were staying there for days, and so we were staying there, we're sitting around, we didn't have a whole lot to do. So we said, okay, let's start a daycare center. We're gonna start a childcare center here. There's people with children. We're gonna bring in the kids. And we did that. And then we said, well, this is not, we can't keep them here in this classroom. So we did this research. I wasn't part of this brigade, but one brigade went into the Columbia files. Secretly went into the files and found out that Columbia owned this big mansion on Riverside Drive. And it was empty. It just had this one kid, this student who was a caretaker. And that's it, a gigantic mansion on 107th and Riverside Drive. And so we said, we're getting that. That's our childcare center and we're getting it. And believe it or not, I was married at the time. My husband, Harry Petchesky, bless his heart, Harry Petchesky was not particularly political, but we got him in, we dragged him in to be our lawyer. And he was great. He even spoke with a bullhorn from the steps of the library and when we were having a demonstration. And we fought like hell to get that mansion. And we got it. We got a mansion. And we hired teachers and we said, this was us then, we said, we're gonna have no hierarchy. We're gonna just have teachers, people from the community, the parents, no differential of pay. Everyone will get paid the same. The food prepare, the food workers, the teachers, everybody. That didn't last. The people from the community didn't like it. They thought that some people should get paid more than other people. And we said, you know, popular control, so we didn't get to say. But that it was called the Children's Mansion. It was a child care center, and it lasted 10 years. That's so amazing. There's 10 years it was there. A real child care center, had lots of kids from the community. Sometimes I think it's the only really good thing I ever did. It was something that lasted. It was really wonderful. And, you know, what else? My mentors. I mean, I don't know. I wasn't a very good political scientist. I was not very involved. I didn't have a good disciplinary sense. I liked history. I liked to, you know, I did my dissertation on prisons and asylums as institutions of social control. And my professors, my political science professors, just said, well, what is that about? You know, that we never heard of that. My mentors were my fellow students who were Marxists, and we were all Marxists. I mean, and it was the time when Foucault's translations were coming into the US. And we were all very, very influenced by Marx and Foucault. I'm sorry to say, two white men, one of them Jewish, but that was it. And so I had a huge debt to those people. It was also there in graduate school that I met my dearest friend of life, Sarah Eisenstein. And I got connected to the Eisenstein family. Sarah was the most amazing person. We met each other, another prison activity. This woman, Louise Yellen, who also was a faculty member a graduate student at Columbia, started this action for, we were called on by women political prisoners in Bedford Hills. And they needed support, and they wanted us to bring in groups, and we brought in music groups, and we brought in and I met Sarah as part of this collective. And the first I laid eyes on her, I said, she's my friend for life. This is the most brilliant. And I realized, you know, that the people who have been most important to me in my life, apart from my immediate family, are my women friends. I'm sorry, my women friends, who are so incredible, brave, smart, just amazing. And that's who carried me through graduate school. I didn't like graduate school. I didn't like Columbia. And when it was time to, I was done. I did get done. I got my dissertation done and I said, all right, I'm gonna deposit my dissertation, then I'm gonna smash something. So I went all around the steps and all around the statues and stuff. I said, and everything was, you know, what's the word? It was nailed into the ground. What's the word? Riveted. It was down into the ground. There was nothing you could smash. It was all made of concrete and marble and granite. And I was so frustrated. I said, I'm out of here. So I did start teaching there, and I taught at Columbia for 1 year. I was very pregnant and was also involved in the women's liberation movement. I don't know. Do we have time? Do we want to go? What do you want to do, Natalia? One funny story?
Well, first I just want to say it's really amazing to hear about these friendships, in particular about Sarah and her legacy. So I just wanted to thank you for bringing that. I would love to hear more about CARASA and the other organization you were part of.
Yeah, and I just meant to say that Sarah was the older sister of Zila Eisenstein, and Zila and Fanny Eisenstein, who is their mother, who just, my heart, they're my heart. I don't think I'd have a single idea without them, not one single idea. CARASA was something that we started in the 70s. CARASA meant the Committee for Abortion Rights and Against Sterilization Abuse. It was a response to the Hyde Amendment. The Hyde Amendment was this congressional amendment to ban Medicaid funding for abortion. And we said, no, that's how poor women get their health care. No, this is intrinsically racist and classist. So we founded CARASA, the Committee for Abortion Rights and Against Sterilization of Youth. I have this artifact here. This was our little book, Women Under Attack. You can't, oh, the writing's backwards, right?
No, I can see it, yeah.
Oh, Women Under Attack, Abortion, Sterilization, and Sterilization Abuse and Reproductive Freedom. We use the term reproductive freedom. And we were trying to bring together an analysis that said all of these issues, plus work, plus sex, sexuality, plus domestic violence, these are all integrally related. And we were, I think, very indebted to what we now call an intersectional analysis. But the Combahee River Collective Statement was in 1978. It was, you know, a beacon for us. And I will say, I told Natalia this. I mean, I did a lot of writing and I wrote some books and articles and a lot of stuff. Every single thing I ever published or wrote came out of activism. Every single thing. There was no other thing that interested me. So I did write books. I did teach. I love teaching. And I will say that my students were some of my most important mentors. I mean, you just can't believe the students I had at Hunter College. I had, in one class, I had Rabab Abdulkhadi, who became my lifelong friend, Rihan Barghouti, Suher Hamad, the poet. I mean, how lucky was I? I was just teaching, honestly, is just a form of learning. Mm-hmm. You know, teaching is a collective form of learning. Mm-hmm. And those of us who have been able to do it are so, so lucky, so privileged. And, you know, I could say all the things that I did. I mean, we had strikes at, before I went to Hunter, I went to Ramapo College and I was a young professor there for 15 years. And we didn't have any traditional, you know, departments. We had the program in labor studies, social relations, environmental studies. Those were our departments that people majored in. We had the first all strike of an all state college system, and the auto workers down the road supported us because we had supported them in their strike. Mm-hmm. We were very kind of labor conscious. And I think that, you know, we have to really think through the role of labor unions, mm-hmm, in our work. Not police unions, but yeah, labor and work. And that we are, you know, we are all workers of a kind, some way more privileged than others. I hesitate, I was gonna say, to make any prescriptions or lessons or anything like that about teaching in higher education, because the institutions are so transformed today, so corporatized, so bureaucratized. You know, frankly, I finally couldn't stand it anymore. I love my students, adore them, learn so much from them, but the institution just became intolerable. It changed so much. Also, I probably would have been very challenged to do a lot of, you know, online learning. Technology was not my strong suit, but I finally decided to retire from teaching because of that, but also because I wanted to do other things. But I will say that it's so changed that I think it's a very different situation now. It's much harder, much harder. I went from Ramapo to Hunter College. I was such a badass, stupid, naive person. I mean, I went there and they hired me to be the head of the Women's Studies program. And I went there, I had tenure at Hunter College, I mean at Ramapo College, for nothing. What had I done? They gave me tenure because Hal Benenson, who was my dearest, he was Sarah's husband, and he later became my husband after Sarah died. He fought my tenure case. And I got tenure. I said, what? I had a tenure. But anyway, I went to Hunter and I said, oh, I'm not coming here without tenure. I mean, I have tenure already. I'm not going to give up tenure, so give me tenure. And this is, and I got to be the head of women's studies because it was just a different time, entirely different. The person who was most instrumental in hiring me was Jeanetta Cole. You know who Jeanette is? Mm-hmm. I mean, the fabulous Jeanetta Cole. Love that woman. You know, she later became the president of Spelman College. She's a fabulous and great radical. And, you know, she was head of, you know, the Venceremos Brigade. She was fantastic. And Audre Lorde was there. And Jeanetta and Audrey decided, well, we really want a woman of color, but we haven't been able to identify someone who can take that job. So you're the next best thing. Audre Lorde was, oh my God, to be there. I mean, my best story about Audre was when she was speaking at, there was this Simone de Beauvoir conference at NYU, the 30th anniversary of the publication of The Second Sex. And Audre was speaking there, and I didn't know who she was. This was 1979, I think, was something. And I went, 1979. And I heard this, and she's standing there saying, I'm a Black lesbian feminist woman, poet, artist. And she rattled off all these things. And then she was speaking, and she was so fierce. And I thought she was enormous. I thought she was about 6 feet tall. And of course she wasn't. This was like the white feminist in, you know, the suffrage movement who looked at Sojourner Truth and thought she was a giant. I mean, it's so racist. It's so stupid. But anyway, years later, Audre was a very, very close friend of my friends, Blanche Cook and Claire Koss. And Blanche and Claire were having a birthday party, and Audre was there. And Audre and I were everyone was dancing. And Audre and I were dancing together. And I looked at her and I said, Audre, you're not even taller than me. It was just a funny thing. She was amazing. We had the Audre Lorde Women's Poetry Center. Those days were really incredible. To be an activist in those days was just a great privilege. There were resources. You want to move on, Natalia?
I kind of would like to talk a little bit more about women's studies and just kind of challenges and opportunities, tensions you found between the line between academia and activism?
Well, this is part of the message here. I mean, my main, if I get anything across here, it's that historical context is everything. You know, it's like Marx said, people make their own history, but not just as they choose. They do it in a context of conditions and circumstances not of their making. So I consider every single thing, sometimes I think it's just luck, but no, I was in a particular historical moment. And this was a time when, you know, Black and Puerto Rican studies was starting, women's studies, you know, the ethnic studies programs. We were starting these things, these programs, and trying to institutionalize what we believed. We taught courses, we taught whatever we wanted. We built a curriculum as we wanted. And it had to be feminist and it had to be anti-racist. I mean, I went to be head of the women's studies program at Hunter and I looked, this is really not nice. I'm not such a nice person, but I looked at this policy committee of the women's studies program and they were all white. And I said, no, this isn't happening here. This is an international, multiracial, multi-ethnic college, and we are going to be what this college is. So I kind of fired all those people and I hired, I said, all right, every woman of color on the faculty is going to be on our policy committee. And I made some wonderful friends that way, just amazing people. we had a lot of success. I think I told Natalia that we had a big pot of money called, because Bella Abzug had gone to Hunter, and there was this Bella endowment of a Bella Abzug lecture series. And that, you know, I was in charge of it. So I said, okay, first one, we're having Jeanetta Cole. Then we're having Maxine Hong Kingston. Then we're having, oh, who did we have? We just had this extraordinary, oh, what was her name? The lesbian Puerto Rican who was such a mentor to so many Puerto Ricans in New York City. Oh my God. I'm sorry, this is age. But we just had this series, and June Jordan. I was so in love with June Jordan, the best, most radical, most thoughtful poet intellectual ever. So we got to do all those things, and I think it's harder now, but we did them in coalition, and we did them in very strong connection to our students and who they were. So I, in that time, I got involved. I guess the president of Hunter was Donna Shalala. You know who she is?
Mm-mm.
Okay, well, Donna Shalala, she was the chancellor of the University of Wisconsin. She was the president of the University of Miami. Then she became the secretary of Health and Human Services in the Clinton administration? I think. Anyway, she was president of Hunter College at that time, and she was famous because she was a tiny, tiny person, much smaller than me. She was so tiny. And I went to interview at her office, and she was sitting on a couch, and I walked in. She didn't say hello. She didn't say anything. She just said, I'm interested in power. It was, well, I thought it was strange. And why was I talking about Donna Shalala? Oh, right, okay. So she sent me to Ireland to this international feminist conference. And I went there and I came back and I said, all right. She said, we're gonna have this here at Hunter the next year. I said, oh my God. I said, all right. So I organized a whole thing on reproductive and sexual rights in transnationally and in third world countries. And I invited 18 people. That was the start of something that would be called the International Reproductive Rights Research Action Group. It was a project that involved 7 countries. We had researchers and activist teams. There had to be activists and researchers together, working together in 7 countries. That was Philippines, Brazil, Mexico, Malaysia, Nigeria, US, and Egypt. Egypt. Wow. And those women, they were all women, were just extraordinary. I learned so much from all those women who were part of the IRAG project. Mm. And we had a team of research advisors who included Beth Ritchie, who's now one of the greatest feminist abolitionist theorists and writers and activists with insight, and teaches at University of Illinois in Chicago. We had a fabulous time, and it was the time of all those big UN conferences, mm-hmm. the Conference on Population and Development and on the Beijing Women's Conference. And we were really very involved in all of them. We did panels, we presented ideas, we caucused, and that's when, you know, Bella Abzug was the head of something called the Linkage Caucus. That was, she was trying to be intersectional, linking all the issues. Mm. I worked with a very dear, inspiring friend named Rhonda Copeland. Rhonda Copeland was a feminist lawyer who worked at the Center for Constitutional Rights. She worked with Michael Ratner for years. She was an extraordinary person who worked in Algeria, in Brazil, in Argentina, and she was one of the most people most responsible for getting sexual issues and violence against women into the International Criminal Court statute mm-hmm. in 1998. She was such a hard worker and such a genius. She was amazing. And Rhonda and I were kind of partners in crime. We worked together at all. We worked these meetings. And we were proudest, I guess, of having developed the idea that your body is your own. You own your body. And we wanted to put that in all the language of all the documents. And we fought the, there were some feminists who said, no, that's too radical, or that's, that they could apply that to the fetus. And they could say, well, the fetus owns his body. We said, no, that's ridiculous. So we fought hard for that idea. But, you know, years later, I realized, you know, we didn't invent something. Mm. Ideas are not property. Mm. Ideas are in the world. Everybody owns ideas. You can't own your ideas. There's no such thing as intellectual property for ideas. We were just lucky we were there. It was in the ether. And, you know, we tried to advocate for these ideas and to organize around them and to go outside when the institutions were just fucking up. We'd go outside and march and have demonstrations. So we worked hard and in the Cairo conference in 1994 and the Beijing conference in 1995. And even the Copenhagen conference around social development, that's one thing I am proud of. The Copenhagen conference and one of the PrepComs, the preparatory committee meetings in Geneva, I was working hard. This was one of my books, was called Global Prescriptions. And what we were fighting for was the idea that access to essential medicines is a human right. Mm. And we convinced the South Africa delegation to take that on, and they took it to the rest, and it got into the, I mean, this sounds so, you know, language matters and it doesn't, but it does matter in some situations. Mm. And so that was a victory. Mm-hmm. And we ought to treasure our victories because they're very few and far between. This victory this week, this incredible 15,000 people demonstration for Black trans lives, the biggest, not only the biggest for Black trans lives, but for trans lives. There's never been a bigger demonstration for trans lives. And we were always in our work for sexual and reproductive and justice and sexual rights. I mean, we started something called Sexuality Policy Watch based in Rio de Janeiro. And we had many meetings and many, that's where I met Alok, by the way, wonderful Alok. We brought together so many incredible trans and intersex, Amaro Cabral, amazing Argentinian intersex philosopher, brought into this circle of analysis and action, and very strong in supporting sex workers. And I forgot to wear my t-shirt that says Star Whores from a Malaysian sexual rights group. But anyway, we were able to do these things because it was a certain context. Mm-hmm. And now we've got this, and we've got this Supreme Court decision. That's big. But that Black trans demonstration builds off of Black trans movements, builds off of Black Lives Matter movement, Black trans lives movement, builds off Black Lives Matter movement, and all these others. So it's a layering and a layering and more will come, and it's not foreordained that we'll win. It's not. You know, Charlene Carruthers just moved me to pieces, you know, in the webinar on celebrating Juneteenth of critical resistance. And Charlene said, it's a lot of work. Mm. We have to work hard. And the other thing she did was say, she's going back to get her PhD in political science. And I was just, I went, wow, you're doing that? And you're doing it now? That's really brave. Charlene, you go for it. And she's going to study with Kathy Cohen and Beth Ritchie, I bet, in Chicago. It's just, this things come, circles come around. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, Natalia, guide me.
That's amazing. All of that is already touching on all the questions that I had laid out. I guess one of the last things I wanted to talk about was how you became involved in JVP, since that is how I know you, how why we are all here together.
Yes, we are. And I wouldn't be here, and I wouldn't even be smiling if it weren't for all of you. JVP is my soul right now. And this group of JVP, especially young people, just makes me happy, makes me believe, makes me feel promise for the future. I got involved in JVP actually in, I think it was 2014. It was before, the Gaza massacre in 2014. It was somebody asked me, somebody said, well, this organization, Jewish Voice for Peace, is doing an action, trying to divest from TIAA CREF. That was our pension. And I should be grateful to TIAA CREF. That's why I'm retired. I have this great pension. Well, they were going to TIAA CREF, was having a meeting at Harvard with the head of TIAA CREF, the president of it, who happened to be a black man who used to work with McKinsey and had gone to Harvard. You know, the kind of, she was sort of an Obama type. And we were gonna go there, and we would confront him and tell him why he should divest, you know, from everything to do with Israel. And of course I believed in that. I mean, I had all my Palestinian mentors and students and everybody to inspire me about supporting justice for Palestine through all the years. So this was something concrete that I could do. So I went there, and it was just a room in the Harvard Club, and there were only about 20 people, and I kept raising my hand, and I was right in the second row. Kept raising my hand, and this guy who was running it never would call on me, and he would never call on me, ever, till the thing was ended. Mm. And I thought, well, that's pretty sexist. What's that all about? And I went up to the guy, the president, afterwards, and I said, listen, I'm here to tell you this and this and this, and this is why you should divest. TIAA CREF should not be investing in these, you know, Israel-related funds. And he said, well, I am only responsible to my, donors, my people, you know, the stockholders, whatever they were. It was just very, very disillusioning. And so after that, there was the Gaza, you know, Israel massacring Gaza for the third time. And I went to a JVP meeting at Tammy Gold's house. And I was just, you know, I said, this is it. And then the first NMM, National Membership Meeting I went to, which is in, I think the first one I went to was in Baltimore. Mm-hmm. I said, oh my God. This is my political home. I mean, Rhonda and I had tried going to a JVP, I mean, to a new Jewish agenda meeting. And oh my God, it just didn't work for us. I think we were too secular. but JVP just sang to me the politics that it brought together, the clear anti-racism, the clear support of Palestine and taking risks to do that. I said, well, this is what I've been looking for most of my life. So I'm very, I feel lucky. I just feel lucky to have been part of all of these incredible groups. And now we're in this moment that feels revolutionary, right? I mean, feels completely, who would have expected any of this? And yet, as Natalia reminded us, the killings go on every single day. The killings go on. I started to say every single fucking day, and you guys, we had this big discussion about fuck the police and whether we were going to say that. yeah, we have so much work to do, and it's really, we don't want to be get carried away by, we want to celebrate our victories, but not lose sight of the fact that the forces against us are enormous. And we have this election coming up, and we just have tons of work to do. And that work has to be done in coalition. It has to be done with people of color organizations in the lead, critical resistance. Yeah, is just an amazing organization. I want to lift up a couple of other organizations. Can I put that in now? Yeah. Well, I do. We use this series as a fundraiser. And I mentioned Eyewitness Palestine earlier because I went on two of their delegations, and they are very politically woke, amazing organization. You will meet incredibly brilliant and courageous and Palestinian leaders if you go on one of their delegations. And they're now having the delegations that are virtual. So you can go on the virtual delegations until it's time when we can travel again. I want to also lift up, speaking of Palestine, Grassroots Al-Quds. Maybe somebody could put that in the chat. Grassroots Al-Quds, one of its leaders is Fairuz Sharkawi. Fairuz is a student of another person, feminist, who has, you know, she's just shaped my thinking so much, and I'm diverting here, but Nadara Shalhub Kavorkian, Nadara, I'll put it in the chat. And you have to read every single word she ever wrote. Nadara, wait a minute, I'm not gonna do this. Whoops. Okay. Just Google her. Okay. Nadra lives with her husband Gabby in occupied Jerusalem. Her books are about Palestinian children, about Palestinian families, about this, what she calls security theology, are extraordinary. I gave a lecture in Cambridge University a couple of years ago where I only talked just about Nadra's ideas, because I learned so, so much from her. And Fairuz with Grassroots Al-Quds is one of her students. And Fairuz leads, you know, she led us on a whole tour of Jerusalem when we were there in 2017. We were just blown away. Fairuz is so intense and so brilliant. And it's like having, you know, a tour of the Nakba in Jerusalem and its effects in Jerusalem. So I love Grassroots Al-Quds, and they're trying hard to raise money because of COVID. All these organizations have really lost funds. So please, if you can, give them support. They're a small organization that only relies on friends and donors. They don't have any kind of big, you know, conditional funding tied to donor agendas at all. But the other one I want to call out is Sister Song. Sister Song Women of Color Reproductive Justice Collective, if somebody could put that in the chat. They are really the, you know, carrying the banner of reproductive justice. And the ideas that I think we had in Karasa, but they've developed so much further. You know, Loretta Ross, Lynn Roberts, my friend, who also teaches at Hunter in public health. This organization is a women of color organization based in Atlanta, and devoted to making the idea of reproductive justice an everyday word, just like Black Lives Matter is an everyday word. They are having an event on Saturday, which I am going to attend, and I hope you will too, an online event, which is to honor the mothers who have lost their children to state violence. And there's a link even to that event. If anybody could find it, Sister, or if you go to the Sister Song, website, you'll see that event. It's actually, putting parenting in healthy and safe environments, doing that is a human right. And this is what Loretta Ross believes in so strongly, and Lynn too, Lynn Roberts. And they've developed the idea of reproductive justice as firmly grounded in international human rights. So I want to call their name.
Yeah.
Say their name.
Yeah. If folks have been to this series before, they know that right around 5 o'clock, we kind of switch gears. People can write in questions for the Q&A that you want to ask Roz, things that we haven't touched on yet. And also, if you feel comfortable, if you can put the amount that you are donating to either Sister Song or Grassroots El Quds, kind of gives us a way to both count what we have donated and also kind of encourages others. So we can kind of take a minute to switch gears while people write questions and look at these organizations. Yay, it's good to see the donations coming in.
Thank you.
And make sure to write any questions that you have for Roz so we can get to them during the Q&A.
And I see my very, very dear Rabab Abdelkhadi is here with us. I am so grateful that she's here. All of you are here. Thank you so much. But do donate also to Rabab's fund for her case at San Francisco State University. I'll send it. We can put Rabab's. We already did that in Chatsi's elder conversation, but we can remind people of that link too, okay? If somebody could put that.
So Roz, we have a few questions.
Okay.
I can read out a few of them and then you can pick which one to start with. So Esther asked about, can you speak more about racism within the feminist movement of white feminists? How did that manifest in the day-to-day work? Someone else asked about navigating the neoliberal university as a grad student today. I'll be taking notes, advice you have. And then someone else asked, they say, I went to a small liberal arts school where there was a tremendous town-gown divide. So I was moved to hear about the connections between your academic community with the local community. Could you speak more on that point and the relationships that were formed? So we can kind of start with any of those and then address them as time passes.
Okay, well, first of all, the racism in the women's movement, it's been there and it is still there. If you look at who got lifted up as the big heroes of feminism, the Gloria Steinems and the Hillary Clintons. I mean, Hillary got credited for this idea that women's rights are human rights. And women of color and women in many countries working collectively throughout the third world, through Asia, Africa, and Latin America, developed that idea. And she got credited with it. So, I mean, that isn't to say that there isn't racism amongst feminists, but I think that the singular focus on gender and women, while it served a purpose in certain circumstances, it just didn't work. It was just too limited and too exclusionary. And we had to learn a lot. And we also, you know, I think that when we developed courses in women's studies, it was a long time coming. You know, Barbara Smith and Sherry Moraga and the authors of This Bridge Called My Back, and, you know, Gloria Watkins Bell Hooks and Zila Eisenstein, I shout out her name as one of the very strongest anti-racist abolitionist feminists, and Angela Davis in her very first book on race, class, and sex. Those works were works of feminist theory. They were works that theorized and analyzed and called to action. And they needed to be at the center of all of our teaching. And it took too long. It took a long time for that to happen. And I, you know, I hold myself responsible as much as anybody else. I think that in Carasa, let's go back to there. Carasa was a wonderful organization. I think we had an impact. But our work, Carasa, Women Under Attack, my first book, Abortion and Women's Choice, were not really strongly anti-racist, mm-hmm. as they should have been. There was just too little attention mm-hmm. to the ways in which Black women's lives mattered and were in a different situation from white women's lives. I think we were much, and I think, honestly, I'm just thinking out loud here, but a lot of this came out of our Marxist formation in those days. Mm. We were so focused on class mm-hmm. and labor, and we were not fully understanding, and I say we as white feminists, we were not fully understanding the ways in which racism inflected everything. So some of it we had to learn from our students. We had to be pushed. The students who were part of the Audre Lorde Women's Poetry Center at Hunter College were just amazing poets and teachers. The Palestinian students, Rabab, Riham, Suher, they were teaching us. We had to be pulled by our students. We were so lucky that we were in, I mean, when I was looking for a job as a young professor, you know, I told my professors at Columbia, no, I'm only interested in a job in a working class in maybe a community college or a state college. I'm not looking to any elite school, sorry. And they said, oh, good, goodbye. And they didn't have to, they thought they didn't have to do very much to get me a job, help me get a job. We were really lucky. And I mean, somebody asked a question about
two questions so far about the university kind of navigating the neoliberal university. You talked a little bit about kind of like the corporatization of it, and then about bridging the divide between the town and the university, or the community and the university if it's in a city.
Right, okay, well, we didn't do that when I was an undergraduate, but in graduate school, when we were starting the daycare center, we just went door to door. I mean, this was Columbia University. It was the Upper West Side of Manhattan. We went door to door and we said, you know, do you need childcare? Are you interested in a childcare center? So we actually organized a very multiracial Black, Latinx, white people. And we brought them all together in a room and we started the conversation and they took over and they did it. And we, you know, so that was how we did that. Columbia students were always engaged. They fought building a gym in Morningside Park, if you remember. That was a big struggle in 1968. And before the anti-war movement, that Columbia was going to build a gym in Morningside Park. And the students rose up against it and said, not over our dead bodies. You're not doing that. That's the people's, you know, that's Harlem. That's, you can't do that. And at Hunter, you know, Hunter College and CUNY, I mean, I really love Hunter and CUNY. I taught at Hunter College in the Graduate Center. You kind of felt like, well, the community was there because that's who our students were. They were first in their families to go to college. Most of them, I would have as many as like 18 different languages in my class. I would always ask what language you spoke. And I learned that from Rabab, who is, by the way, amazing teacher. And I would learn that my students, they came from everywhere. And they were, a lot of them, you know, very politically astute. Now, some weren't. But, you know, you'd have a big mix. Some had trouble with writing. A lot of them had trouble with writing. And so you'd spend a lot of time, you know, coaching writing and learning from people and having conversations in class. The classroom had to be an organizing space. It just had to be. And so I don't think that's impossible today. I mean, I think the community is, if you're in a public sector institution, a public school, a public sector university, the community is there. That's your community. And you have a lot of work to do to serve that community and bring together, you know, progressive people on your faculty. The faculty is always way behind the students. Mm-hmm. I mean, and it's much wider than the students at a place like Hunter, much wider. So you're kind of fighting the administration all the time. We had, I mean, our women's, now it's called the Women and Gender Studies Program at Hunter, is terrific. And it's done, you know, a lot of work on consciousness about trans students. Jen Gabori, who's now, she's actually, temporarily heading the union at Hunter, but she did these amazing things about bathrooms, you know, and working with trans students on the politics of bathrooms. It's just endless, the work to do, working with cafeteria workers. You know, I mean, I was always learning things. At Ramapo College, the students went on strike because they want to get more faculty of color, and they had dorms. They lived in Newark and places like that, and Ramapo was off in the suburbs, and a lot of them came from the inner cities, and they were, one of their demands was to get dogs out of the dorms, because the white students wanted their pets, their dogs. And I always had pets. I had a dog. Well, I don't get it. I had to really think that through and understand the dogs. I mean, I knew that dogs were used in the civil rights movement against people, but I had to learn that. At Hunter, the students, you know, way back, I mean, they all went out on strike, same thing, to diversify the curriculum and the faculty. And my friend Stuart Ewan, who's a really dear friend, who was a professor there with me, and we, you know, we just hung out with the students. We stayed overnight in the they took over building. Oh, they occupied a whole administrative building. We went in there. We brought them blankets and food. So I was always kind of an outlier in a way from the mainstream of the faculty. And somehow I did things and got acknowledgement that I probably didn't deserve, but it was just a better time. For now, this time somebody said, well, if you're teaching now, or you're going into, what was the question, Natalia?
Kind of like navigating the university today.
Yeah, right. Well, you have to be strong. I think it's much harder. I think people like me came in with a lot of assumptions that, you know, we had privileges and that we could do whatever we wanted. I always thought I could do whatever I wanted. I mean, when I was 5 years old, I took my brother. I had four brothers, by the way. That will toughen you up. My next youngest brother, Nathan, was a year and a half younger than me, and I was five and he was three and a half, and I said, okay, Nathan, we're gonna run away, so let's get our stuff, we're gonna go to our grandparents' house and run away from our parents. And we did. Took him, and we had to cross a big busy street, and we went to our grandparents. I think that was my first rebellion. I think this is totally comes out of white skin class privilege, to believe deep down in your heart, and despite being female, a woman, a cis woman, not a lesbian and not a trans person, that you could do anything you wanted. Mm-hmm. You could do anything you wanted, just do it. And really, that belief was empowering, but it was also very diluted, mm-hmm. and very came out of that privilege. And it was not helpful in really understanding what other people are going through, especially people who are not in your situation, who do not have your privileges and your resources. And so that is the biggest struggle you have. Mm. Not even the struggle against the administration or the white racists in your faculty or all that. The biggest struggle you have is in yourself. If you are a white person, including a white Jewish person, to come to terms with the fact that you grew up surrounded by white supremacy, you are a part of it, you benefit from it, you don't have the same experience as people of color. I try to learn from my partner, who's African American. Bless his heart, Ron June, I adore you. And I do learn from you every single day, but your experience and mine are not the same. When we're in the street, which we can't be now, holding hands, which we can't be now, you don't like it. You'd say, no, mm-mm. My experience in Mississippi tells me this is dangerous. I don't care, we're in New York City. We're not gonna stand here and hold hands. And I have to think deeply and think, well, what's wrong? I mean, why can't we do that? Mm-hmm. And it's completely a different experience. And we have to understand. I think a lot of you guys have gone way further than I have in that direction. I know you have. I see Esther there. Esther, as a Palestinian Jew and someone working in Brooklyn College with the Puerto Rican students, you have a way better insight than I do. I need to learn from you. Well, was there another question?
Yeah, that was really powerful. I guess before the last question, I just wanted to do some brief announcements so we can end with Roz's answer and not kind of like some housekeeping details. That along with the movement, the series with movement elders, every week JVP does a weekly phone bank with Free Them All. And so that's tomorrow at noon. The info will go in the chat. And then also at 5:30 today, after this conversation, you can stay on this Zoom, and we're going to have a very special birthday for one of our members, which will be really wonderful. And so stay if you can. And then I guess I will, I wanted to close with talking about, last week we talked a lot about abolition with Kayi, and I was wondering if we can, if I could ask you about prisons and police and why it is so important for white feminists to support the call for abolition.
We have a huge open door now, huge. People rising up, not just in this country, but all over the world. And we've learned, and we've had to learn a lot in the last few weeks. I mean, I was reading about abolition and I was, you know, trying to think about prisons, but I was not a totally abolitionist feminist until pretty recently. And my friend Zila and Angela Davis, Charlene Carruthers, Beth Ritchie, Mariam Makaba, they are our teachers. And they are teaching us the ways in which the prison industrial complex is at the bottom of racist systems. It's very much at the bottom. It's what divides, you know, white communities. I have a brother who was in prison. I have a brother who was in prison for a federal judge drug charge for almost 2 years. I should know something about prisons. I studied it. I wrote my dissertation on it. But the idea of abolition is so radical and yet so necessary. Because what they've taught us is that the culture of violence and of something like the death of George Floyd and all the others who've been killed wantonly really is deeply linked to the institutions where white supremacy is in control. And that is number one, I think, the prisons and the police. They're the ones who are the sentries, mm-hmm. you know, they're the guards. And they're the ones, the police particularly, who allow white people to feel, oh, well, I'm okay, I'm safe. You know, they'll protect me. I was very, very deeply moved when Eric Garner was killed, murdered in Staten Island. And I went marching into Staten Island and I went on demonstrations. I went to, there was a big one in Washington Square Park. And I went and I was looking for all you guys, the JVP people. And I was walked, I was a little bit early. And all of a sudden, this huge guy, I mean, I'm not very tall, this big guy, but he had a huge video camera on his shoulders, and he crashed into me, and I crashed down to the ground, and I broke my shoulder and tore my rotator cuff, and I'm lying down there in a lot of pain. And all of a sudden, and I was yelling, and we were all yelling, not racist police. We weren't yelling, fuck the police. We were yelling, racist police, racist police, racist cops, blah, blah, blah. And I was part of that. And then I get knocked down and then I look up and I'm surrounded by a circle of about a dozen white cops. And they were going, we'll get the EMR, we'll get you taken care of. Oh, it was quite a moment to say, yeah. Mm. Little old white lady, we'll take care of you. Mm-hmm. Just let it register, let it sink in. Every time you have one of those experiences, who you are and who you're not and what you want to do because of who you are and the resources you have to change this world. Abolish police, abolish prisons, abolish racism and white supremacy forever and ever. Tulsa, you bring it on because you're changing. You're pushing for reparations. You're learning. Tulsa, you're not the Tulsa I grew up in, I hope. And, you know, things are changing. We're in a time of change. I'm so lucky to be alive. Mm-hmm.
This has really been such a wonderful conversation. I don't remember how we do the closing on these, but if there's just me on behalf of everyone, I wanted to thank you for sharing with us. And then I wanted to pass it over right to the next event. But I do just want to take a moment to really thank you, Roz, for sharing with us. This was a really incredible conversation. I'm very grateful to have been here. And I'm so happy it gets to be recorded so that I can listen to it again and really just soak in everything that you were saying.
Thank you, Natalia. I love you so much. And Jay and Morgan and Elena and all of you guys. Thank you.